Bill, as a son of a python, you know that the python story is a very, very intriguing one with lots of ups and downs. What made you want to focus specifically on Graham Chapman?
I mean, my memories of Graham were quite vague, and my strongest memory is actually going to his memorial. And one of the reasons why it was my strongest memories is because afterwards we went and did a 20th party. And I got very drunk, and I think I was quite young at the time. That was probably the first time I got drunk. So
Graham would have approved of
it. Yes. Yeah, but approved of underage drinking. Uh-huh. With Graham not being around in these past 20-odd years, he's been forgotten about a bit, and we just really wanted to celebrate his achievements and the things that he did done and has done, and get some of the nice things that, and just show him off a little bit, really.
Mm-hmm. And Terry, let's move on to you. The film paints Graham as a very complex individual. Did you ever really understand him during your time in Python?
No, I don't think I did, actually. I think he didn't understand himself, really. I think he was looking for who he was. He found himself as a homosexual. But then I think, you know, David Sherlock says that actually he would have probably gone straight in the end.
For a change.
He found himself as an alcoholic. He styled himself as an alcoholic, but mm-hmm. then he gave up alcohol just like that. Mm-hmm. I think he was in search of whoever he was.
Did this film illuminate any aspects of his character you perhaps hadn't seen before?
I think it's only seeing this film that it strikes me that that's what he was doing. He was trying to find himself.
Absolutely. And Michael, I'm going to head off the inevitable question at the pass. doing this film with Terry in the booth, doing all these voices, and, yes. and John's involved and Terry Gilliam's involved, is this as close to a Python reunion as we're going to get?
Well, it is in strange... We're all reunited in different parts of the world, really. Very odd. Yeah. It's a bit of a homage to Gray, because he was remarkable. And I remember before we even did Python, Terry and I had watched at last the 1948 show, and which John Cleese and Graham Chapman and Tim Brooke Taylor, Marty Feldman and others did, and were really impressed by Graham's sort of stillness, the fact he didn't really seem to act very hard. And he was absolutely sort of, your eye was drawn to him because he just was there. And that's one of the way Graham was, generally.
I think so, because the first time I ever saw him was at the Wyndham's Theatre when they were doing Cambridge Circus. And we were doing another review in the Oxford Review. It was called Four Asterisks. It didn't have a name. It was called, we called it...
And it would be called Fuck now, wouldn't it?
Yeah. but I went in into the Wyndham Theatre where they were doing a matinee. The Cambridge Circus were doing a matinee, and I couldn't take my eyes off Graham, because I could see what everybody else was doing. They were being funny, you know. They were acting, and Bill Oddie and Tim Brooke Taylor and John Cleese were being funny. But Graham looked like he'd walked in off the street and was just was surprised to be there. And I think that made him our lead actor. And that's why we cast him in as Arthur in The Holy Grail and as Brian in The Life of Brian, because he was our lead performer. Mm. And he was just himself on screen.
Mm. He was bloody good. Mm.
We decided we had to use animation because Graham was sadly unavailable to yeah. to take part in his own life story, apart from the tapes that we found.
Indeed.
But the book that it's based on, it goes off into fantastic flights of fancy, and he takes you down kind of dark alleys and up into space, and it's a kind of lots of madness, really. So it's probably something that we could only do in animation, you know, unless we've been filming in space. And inside his mind and all those other crazy places that he takes us to. But we wanted to use different... It was always part of the plan to use lots of different styles of animation to reflect not just those different places that he goes, but also the different tones of the humour. Some of it is quite dark. The bit in Los Angeles at the end is quite cool, but quite detached.
Yeah.
So we were able to match the styles of the animation to the styles of his writing and the humour. Hopefully. What was the second part of the question?
Yeah. Oh, I was going to ask Ben. I mean, you found those tapes of Graham, those audio tapes. Was that a godsend? At which point in the production did you find those?
I mean, probably Jeff should answer that because he actually found them and brought them to us. I think.
Yeah, I went up to see David Sherlock, who's been mentioned, Graham's partner, hoping actually to do a documentary about Graham, and hoping that David might have, you know, home movies or something that could be materials for a documentary. Sadly, he didn't, but in the course of that conversation, he mentioned that Graham had been into a studio in Los Angeles, Harry Nilsson's studio, and over two nights recorded the entire, 2.5 hours of his autobiography as a kind of early audio book before those things existed, really. So David knew of the tape's existence, but it took me a little while to track them down. Then I pitched it as a documentary with Graham narrating his own life story from beyond the grave with some bits of animation in, which thankfully the BBC turned down, thanks to their foresight and wisdom. And at that point, I walked into Bill and Ben's with some tapes of Graham's voice and some bits of animation.
And we'd just done the endlessly exhaustive documentary series on Monty Python called Almost the Truth. So we really didn't want to do a documentary at Talking Heads, and I don't think you wanted to do any more.
No.
So talking, sitting and talking, like you are now.
I'm not you.
Yeah, right, yeah, so you're right.
But when we said, Terry Jones, would you like to play Graham Chapman's mum? It all clicked.
Yeah, the sort of eureka moment was when we realised that we could just make it as an animated film, and we could bring in the other voices, and we could edit his voice, because we were lucky, because you, when you listen to the book, he does perform in the book. He performs, I mean, not all the time, but most of the time he performs. And bizarrely, he only performs his own lines. So he must have known this was going to happen.
Yes.
He was no interest in doing anybody else's. So, so that was the sort of moment that we thought, let's try and get this made. Let's try and get this done.
Well, a project like this only comes along once in a blue moon, and it was an honour, really, with all the animation companies to work on it. But to have we started with 90 companies, and in the way met them and interviewed them, and between us all, really, what came down to who really wanted to do it, the whites in their eyes, and they're really excited about being involved, and the creative collaboration of the project was really unique and quite pioneering, and the fact that no one had done stereoscopic before in the film. Well, one person, as Jeff keeps saying, who actually lied to us, said he'd done it. So so as far as keeping everyone in control, I think everybody just really wanted to do it. Everyone was so honoured and so wanted to be a part of it, and to be able to hold up things like the original shoe from The Life of Brian and be around this wonderful memorabilia and tell the story of this person. And
no, it's the sandal.
The sandal.
I thought you'd arrived wearing those and decided just to take your sandals off and put them on the table.
No, it was a project that from one little man in Oxford did a sequence to a big company in New York did a sequence. So it really is a lovely branch across all the animation companies, and I think it's a good legacy to animation. So.
You once used the term unconstructive silliness, referring to the Python's humour. How much Graham Chapman was a part of this?
I think Graham was perhaps sillier than all of us. He didn't appear to be. He appeared to be very straight and rather serious about things. But I feel that very often Graham would be silent for a long period in writing, and then after about half an hour we'd say something, oh, it could be a Norwegian blue or something like that, and immediately you've got something there which no one else would have thought of. He did have a way of going to the silliest ideas, and yet, as I say, he was a very sort of seemed a very serious man, so I think he was very, very important to the construction or deconstruction or the silliness, certainly, of Python. And he appreciated silliness, he loved it. which other members of the team didn't quite as much. I mean, John quite liked being silly, but there was a point where he stopped being silly and got very serious, especially about 3:27. Whereas Graham would just be slightly wonderful all the
lemon
time.
Lemon curry.
Lemon curry, yes. He used to say lemon curry and... Betty Marsden, that's it. Yeah, I was when we were filming in Glencoe for Life of Brian, I'd hear Graham
Holy Grail.
Holy Grail, sorry. Oh, did Life of Brian? That was Tunisia. Sorry about that.
Glencoe. Mixed up.
Yeah, it was just one mad word. We're all on drugs. Anyway, I went to bed early, being the nice one of the group, and heard in the corridor, heard Graham coming to bed saying, "Betty Marsden! Betty Marsden!" Then the second night, he comes with, "Betty Marsden, I'm on my own tonight, Betty Marsden." So on the third morning, I said, "Great, you might, it's just... I was trying to get to sleep. Can you just keep be a bit..." So the next night there was silence, no Betty Marsden at all. And I woke up in the morning, it was a little slip of paper pushed under my door, and I got opened it and it said, "Betty Marsden." So he was silly.
1 question for Terry and Michael. We've heard about the tapes, but how was it for you hearing the tapes for the first time? Was it like a voice from beyond the grave? And did it inspire a lot of trips down memory lane like that last answer?
Yeah, I guess so. But it was just natural. It felt just very natural to have Graham's presence in the studio when we were recording the voices. It just felt what it used to be like. It didn't tug at the heartstrings at all, but it was just natural.
It was very, it was brilliant that you found it, because I think Liar's Autobiography is one of the best books about Python, if not the best, partially because it's quite short, and also because it's all lies, and yet within the lies are a lot of truths, and it's a very, very funny book. There's a bit where he comes off the plane after the Canadian tour we all did. We went to Los Angeles and Graham had drunk an awful lot. And he got to this hotel and he was so pissed. First thing he did was ring up and ask them whether he'd checked in or not and if he was in a group or not. And they told him yes. And then he said, "Well, I want to go to my favorite restaurant in LA. Please send a limousine to collect me." And they said, "Are you sure?" And he said, "Yes. Are you sure you want a limousine to take you to this restaurant?" And Graham said, "Yes, I do, you know. I mean, thank you very much." And got quite testy about it and got into the limousine, and the restaurant was just across the road. So there's it's a very funny book, and it was great to hear Graham read it, really. I thought it did bring him back, and I think it's brilliantly interwoven into the film. I don't think the film could have really worked without that voice of Graham going all the way through, and it's rather nice to hear him. I'd never heard him read the book.
Michael, you truly are a globetrotter. You seem to have been everywhere. When you go on your travels around the world, are you astonished at the popularity of Python and how far it reaches? Are you bemused by it? Are you gratified by it? What's the effect that it has on you?
Well, I'm bemused because, I mean, we didn't expect Python to last longer than about 2 or 3 years when we wrote that. That was the life of a television program then. You know, just and nothing was stored and kept. It's not like now, you've got lots of different media and YouTube and all that. So I think the very fact that Python still survives, and did so by the skin of its teeth.
Our Howard Dell, who was our video editor, announced that the BBC were going to wipe the tapes, the first series, in a month's time. And so we smuggled the tapes out of the BBC and with Howard Dell's connivance and recorded it on a Philips VCR, which was
about this big. Yes.
and I thought that that's going to be the only archive of the shows. But fortunately, it then sold to the States and to the PBS in the States, Public Broadcasting Station in the States, and so we were rescued. And actually, we were very lucky because we went out the first week that BBC One went into colour.
And so otherwise we'd have been made in black and white, I don't think the shows have lasted as long as they have.
There's an interesting thing about travelling, because I was in Croatia filming and talking to people who, you know, been Yugoslavs before, part of Yugoslavia. And I remember that we sold Python to Yugoslavia very early on. We also, actually, the first sale, foreign sale, was to Pakistan. Apparently it was a total mistake. They thought it was a circus, you know, and after 13 shows, where are the acrobats, you know, where's the clowns and all that sort of thing. So they had to give their money back. But Yugoslavs took it, and I met some people in Croatia who said, we loved Python because Marshal Tito he was actually quite liberal in some ways, and he allowed people to watch foreign television shows. So Python was current there, and it was kind of used as a badge of courage. If you watched Python and talked about Python, you could relate your own sort of discontent with your own government by saying you watched Python. So it meant something. They kind of rallied round and laughed at their own authority figures through Python. I thought that was quite interesting.
There's a gentleman here.
It's quite interesting.
Was it?
Yeah.
What sort of on 1 to 10? What would you say, Terry?
Yeah, 5.
Hardly worth getting up for.